Good morning. I'm Dr. Somayajulu, Professor of Computer Science and Engineering, National Institute of Technology, Warangal. The title of the module is Data Pre-Processing. This module consists of several lectures. This is the first lecture related to data pre-processing. In this lecture, we discuss three different types of topics, namely, why to pre-process the data, then what are the different kinds of data summarization concepts used, and finally we conclude this lecture by highlighting different data cleaning methods that are widely used in data pre-processing. The first topic is why to pre-process the data. By understanding this topic, you will be able to know why do we need data pre-processing, what are the different forms of data pre-processing, and also understand how to improve the data quality using these methods. Data in organizations' operational systems is not suitable for providing information for making strategic decisions. Data warehousing fulfills the need for strategic information. The information contained in warehouse flows from the same operational systems that could not be directly used to provide strategic information. The set of functions that fall under the group of data extraction, data transformation, and data loading, popularly called as ETL, prepares the operational data from different sources into the desired form so that it can be used directly for deriving strategic information. In view of this, data pre-processing is an important issue for data warehousing, as real-world data tend to be incomplete, noisy, and inconsistent. To analyze the data by manager for desired task, desired data is to be identified first as attributes for the analysis. But while collecting desired attributes, we may notice that there may not be any recorded values for some of the data attribute values of various tuples. In addition to this, database system may record unusual values, sometimes may contain errors and inconsistencies in the data recorded for some transactions. Due to these reasons, real-world data tend to be noisy, incomplete, and inconsistent. In a simple way, whenever there is no attribute value or lacking of certain attributes of interest or containing only aggregated data is termed as incomplete data. For example, designation of a member is not provided, then we consider as null, so which is incomplete. Second point is data can also be noisy. This can generally occurs whenever there are errors or outliers while providing the data by the data entry operators. For example, providing -100 for salary for a particular person can be termed as noisy. Whenever there exists discrepancies in the codes or names of the attributes, then we term as data as inconsistent. For example, age may be provided as a string with number 42 and birthday as 10/10/2001 is an example for inconsistency. Sometimes rating attribute in one source may be termed as 1, 2, 3, and in another source we may name it as ABC. Sometimes there can also a discrepancy exist between the duplicate records. In view of all these reasons, data in the real world is dirty. Collecting data from faulty instrument, wrong data entry by data entry operator, or errors in data transmission are examples for the category of noisy data. Incomplete data may occur in large databases or data warehouses for various number of reasons. Lacking of attribute values, lacking of certain attributes of interest, and containing only aggregated data are examples for incomplete data category. Presence of discrepancies in codes or names is an example for inconsistent data. Quality decisions usually be based on quality data. Therefore, maintaining quality data is very important in data warehouse in order to extract quality-oriented results. If data quality is not properly maintained in the data warehouse, the results of mining process will not provide quality results. For example, duplicate data or missing data may cause incorrect or even misleading statistics. Hence, data warehouse needs consistent integration of quality data. Because of this reason, data pre-processing techniques are very widely used to improve the quality of the data, and it is an important step in the knowledge discovery process. Early detection and rectification of data problems and reduced representation of data generally lead to good payoff for decision making. So in view of these reasons, the data pre-processing is very important. Data extraction, data cleaning, data transformation comprises the majority of the work of building a data warehouse. Generally, 60% of the effort goes in performing cleaning only. Rest of the time we can use for analysis and reporting. So that is to say, data pre-processing play a major role in building data warehouses. This slide talks about what are the different forms of data pre-processing. Various forms of data pre-processing are data cleaning, data integration, data transformation, data reduction, and data summarization. Data cleaning methods are useful to remove noise and correct inconsistencies in the data. Data integration combines data from different sources into a single coherent data warehouse. To improve the accuracy and efficiency of mining involving distance measurements, data is generally converted from one form to another form using data transformation methods. Data reduction is applied to reduce the size of the data by using aggregation. Eliminating redundant features or clustering the data is an example for data reduction. In fact, we can apply all these methods in combination also. Therefore, data cleaning can involve transformations to correct wrong data, such as by transforming all entries for amount attribute to a common form. The main advantage of using data pre-processing are improvement of quality of patterns and improvement of time required for the actual mining. In this lecture, we discuss only data cleaning and data summarization methods. Rest of the techniques will be discussed in the subsequent lectures. This slide talks about different kinds of tasks and what is the role of each task. For example, data cleaning is used to fill in the missing values, to smooth noisy data, to identify or remove outliers, and to resolve inconsistencies. Whereas data integration is used to combine the data from different sources. The sources may be either different databases, or a source may be a data cube, or a file, or a combination of these three. Whereas data transformation normalizes and aggregates the data, and data reduction produces the reduced representation of the data in volume, but gives the same or similar analytical results. Finally, data discretization, which is a part of data reduction, but which is particular importance, especially for numerical data, topic 2. The second topic is descriptive data summarization. The objective of this topic is to understand how the data is distributed, and also you should be able to draw a box plot for a given data set over an attribute. We can also detect outliers in a data set based on the characteristics of the data. Descriptive data summarization provides a clear picture of the data. How it provides the clear picture of the data? By identifying important properties of the data, and also by highlighting which data values should be considered as outliers or noise. These two can very easily be detected by using this descriptive data summarization methods. These concepts will help to identify the basic properties of the data. They are central tendency of the data and dispersion of data. Measures of central tendency are mean, median, and mode, and mid-range. measures of data dispersion are quartiles, interquartile range, and variance. These measures help the user in understanding the data distribution, and they are very widely used in statistics. The notion of distributive measure, algebraic measure, and holistic measures are also important from the data mining perspective. We now discuss the mining data descriptive characteristics. The motivation is to determine the descriptive characteristics. These characteristics will help to identify the typical properties of the data and highlight which data values should be treated as noise or outliers. Before identifying the noisy data, we should know how the data are scattered. It is necessary also to know the notations of descriptive, algebraic, and holistic measures. Descriptive statistics are of great help in understanding the distribution of the data. Suppose if you have n data values, namely x1, x2, etc., xn, for a particular attribute, say x. The first measure is a mean. Mean is an algebraic measure. It is also termed as average. Generally, this is denoted with a symbol mu. This is the most effective measure of the center of a set of data, and it corresponds to the average function of SQL. It belongs to the category of distributive measure. This measure is very sensitive to extreme values. The measure can be computed either by weighted arithmetic mean or by trimmed mean. Trimmed mean means by chopping the extreme values, x1, x2, etc., xn. Then I can compute the mean of the salary by taking x1, x2, xn as values and by summing x1, x2, xn and then finally dividing with n. But it is not always the best way of measuring the center of the data. Even small number of extreme values can corrupt the mean. For example, the average score of a class in an exam could be pulled down quite a bit by a few very low scores. To offset this effect, we remove high and low values of the data and compute mean values. But here, we should avoid trimming large a portion of the data. The second category of measure is a median, which is a holistic measure. Median can be computed by first sorting the distinct values in some order. Then middle value of the ordered set is median if n is odd. Otherwise, the average value of the two middle values is considered as median. This measure is better for skewed data. It is computationally expensive. We can also estimate by using interpolation method. The formula for computing the median using interpolation is shown on the slide, where here L1 is the lower boundary of the median interval and n is the number of values in the entire data set and f is the frequency. Sigma FL is the sum of frequencies of all intervals. F median is the frequency of the median interval and C is the width of the interval. Generally, the median using interpolation is used only for grouped data. The third kind of measure is called mode. You can compute mode by first counting the number of occurrences for each data value called frequency and then select the data value or values with the maximum frequency as mode. Mode is the value that occur most frequently in the data set. Data frequency with one mode, two modes and three modes are termed as unimodal, bimodal and trimodal. When more than two modes exist in a data set, they are called multimodal. When each data value in the data set occurs only once, then there is no mode for it. Then fourth kind of measure is called midrange. This is computed by taking the average of the largest and smallest values in the data set. This midrange is an example for algebraic measure and it can be computed very easily using SQL aggregate functions like max and min. Of course, when two measures of the three, say mean, mode and median are given to you, the third one can be expressed in terms of the remaining two using an empirical formula. Mean minus mode is equal to 3 times mean minus median. Suppose if mean and median are given, I can compute mode using this formula. If mode and median are given, I can compute mean. So that means if any two are given, compute the third one very easily using this empirical formula. In the case of unimodal frequency curves, we can compute one measure from two of the measures are known as the empirical relation. In a unimodal frequency curve, perfect symmetric data distribution, the mean, mode and median are all at the same center value. The slide shows three different kinds of figures. The first figure is called the unimodal frequency curve. Here all the three are same, mean, mode and median are same. Whereas the second figure gives positively skewed data, how mean, mode, median looks like. Whereas the third figure is an example for negatively skewed data. The real data generally is not symmetric. Therefore, the data may be either positively skewed or negatively skewed. Different kinds of dispersion measures. Data dispersion or variance of the data is the spread of the numerical data. Data dispersion measures are range, the 5-number summary based on quartiles, the entire quartile range, and the standard deviation. Outliers identification is done by plotting box plot based on the 5-number summary. Suppose if we have n data elements x1, x2, etc., xn are observations which are arranged in sorted order for an attribute ASA. The first measure is range. Range can be computed by taking the difference between the maximum value, which is the largest value, and the minimum value, which is the smallest value of these n elements. The second one is called quartiles, which is called 25th percentile. Q3 is termed as third quartile, 75th percentile. Kth percentile of a set of numerical order is the value xi having the property that k percent of the data entries lie at or below xi. For example, median is 50th percentile and is called Q2. Then the third one is interquartile range. Interquartile range is the distance between the first quartile and third quartile and is a measure of spread that provides range covered by middle half of the data. Here Q1, Q2 and Q3 are holistic measures. Then the fourth measure is variance. Variance is determined by using a formula sigma square is equal to 1 by n into summation over I is equal to 1 to 1 xi square minus square of the average mu square. The square root of the variance is known as standard deviation, that is sigma. It measures the spread about mean and is considered only when mean is chosen as the measure of center. When there is no spread, then deviation is zero. Otherwise, the deviation may be positive. This measure belongs to the category of algebraic measure. Outliers are identified with the quartiles and interquartile range. That is, by using IQR, Q1 and Q3, min and max. Values failing at least 1.5 times IQR above the third quartile or 1.5 times IQR below the first quartile are considered as suspected outliers. The 5-number summary of a distribution consists of median, the quartiles Q1 and Q3, the smallest value and the largest value are used to draw spread of the data in visual form called box plot. Box plot is generally represented using the following steps. The first step is draw a box by considering the quartiles as ends of the box and box length as IQR. Median is marked by a line within the box. Extend outside box with two lines called whiskers. One line towards the maximum and another whisker towards minimum. So to identify the outliers, we use 1.5 times IQR to compare the values to above third quartile and below the first quartile. For example, the slide shows different kinds of box plots. For example, description of the box plot for an attribute sepal length of iris data. This is the 10th percentile, 25th percentile, 50th percentile, which is median, 75th percentile, which is Q3, 98th percentile. And 1.5 times IQR, Q3 minus Q1, that means above 98th percentile are termed as outliers. These are the outliers here. And this is an outlier. There are four outliers shown in the slide. This is another slide, box plot for each value. This is the box plot for sepal length, box plot says sepal width, box plot for petal length, and box plot for petal width. So the values are measured here in centimeters. And if you observe, the spread of the data for each kind of attribute value is different here. That means to say, the box plots, whenever you draw, they won't give the same results. They give different kinds of width and different kinds of whiskers. The slide gives a visual representation of the box plots. By seeing this, we can understand how the data is spreading in each interval for the profit versus revenue. So far, we discussed how data summarization helps in detecting the outliers. Now we move on to the next topic, namely data cleaning methods. Objective of these data cleaning methods are basically used to compute and predict the missing values in the data. You can also determine outliers in the data, and also you can understand how to smoothen the data using regression and binning techniques. Data cleaning is especially required when integrating heterogeneous data sources, and it must be addressed together with schema related data transformations. In data warehousing, data cleaning is a major part of the so-called ETL process. In the next lecture, we discuss in detail on how ETL works. Data cleaning is also termed as data cleansing or data scrubbing, which is basically deals with detecting and removing errors and inconsistencies from the data in order to improve the quality of the data. Data quality problems are present in single data collections such as files and databases. For example, due to misspellings during data entry, missing information, or other invalid data. When multiple data sources need to be integrated, either in data warehousing or in federated database systems or global web-based information systems, the need for data cleaning increases significantly. This is because the sources often contain redundant data in different representations. In order to provide access to accurate and consistent data, consolidation of different data representations and elimination of duplicate information is very much essential. First of all, it should detect and remove all major errors and inconsistencies, both in individual data sources and also when integrating multiple sources. The approach should be supported by tools to limit manual inspection and programming effort and be extensible to easily cover additional sources. Furthermore, data cleaning should not be performed in isolation, but together with schema-related data transformations based on the comprehensive metadata. Mapping functions for data cleaning and other data transformations should be specified in a declarative way and must be reusable for other data sources as well as for query processing. Especially for data warehouses, workflow infrastructure should be supported to execute all data transformation steps for multiple sources and large data sets in a reliable and efficient manner. So the reason for performing data cleaning is because real world data may be dirty, inconsistent, and incomplete. Dirty data can cause confusion for the data mining process. Why the real world data dirty? Because data warehouse is an information repository where multiple sources are grouped into a single unified schema. During this integration, dirty data might be presented in the resulting schema. So therefore, Data must be cleaned to avoid such problems. There are different kinds of data cleaning tasks. The first is called filling in missing value. Second task is termed as how to identify outliers and smooth out noisy data. Third task is how to correct inconsistent data. And then finally, how to resolve redundancy caused by data integration. So all these tasks are part of data cleaning. We now discuss each one with examples. Data is not always available. For example, many tuples have no recorded value for several attributes. Say for example, age of a person, customer income in sales data, etc. The missing data is because of malfunction of the equipment or inconsistent with other recorded data, or data might not have entered due to misunderstanding and we may give a blank value. Certain data may not be considered important at the time of entry. In that situation also we put a blank value. And sometimes we may not register historical changes of the data. So therefore, we must have a mechanism to infer the missing data. Before filling the missing value, we should also know how the data is collected. What are the reasons for missing? So to handle the missing data, there are different kinds of methods. The simplest method is simply ignore the tuple. This is generally done when the class label is missing in the case of classification. Of course, this ignoring the tuple is not always effective when the percentage of missing values per attribute varies considerably. That means as long as if within the limit, if some percentage of tuples are dropped because of missing value, then it is adequate to consider. If the number of missing values are more, then more tuples we may ignore. In that situation, the percentage of missing values may be very high. So in that situation, we may not use this method. Then second kind of method is manually filling the missing values, which is a very laborious and infeasible process. But it takes more time because a lot of manpower and cost is involved, because the data set may be very large also, and also we need to look at the records manually, which is a very expensive operation. Then another kind of method to fill the missing value is automatically filling of the missing value. One such popular method is called putting a global constant. We use a global constant unknown as a new class to replace all missing values. Another method is replacing every missing value with the attribute mean. That means you take the average of all the values and then replace the missing value with the attribute mean. For example, income of a customer is the missing value of a tuple in a transaction. Assuming the average income of a customer is say 56,000, then use this value to replace with the missing value income for that customer. Then another method is use attribute mean for all samples belonging to the same class, which is a very clever approach. We use the average attribute mean value of all samples belonging to the same class in the given tuple. For example, when we classify the customers according to credit risk, replace the missing value with the average income value for customers in the same credit risk category as that of the given tuple. Then the last method is identify the most probable value. You can determine the most probable value either by using regression technique or by using Bayesian formula or by using decision tree induction. Second kind of data is known as noisy data. Noise is just a disturbance in a measured variable which is having incorrect attribute value. These incorrect attribute values occur maybe because of faulty data collection instrument, or maybe because of data entry problem, or maybe because of transmission problem, or because of limitation of the technology, or maybe naming conventions are not consistent. Sometimes we may come across the data problems with requests to data cleaning as presence of duplicate records or incomplete data or inconsistent data. Incorrect data may also be the result from inconsistencies in naming conventions or data codes. When multiple sources are integrated into a single schema, noise data may be the result of lack of good integration techniques. That is the reason why consistent integration is very important. To handle the missing data, we use different kinds of methods. They are binning methods, regression methods, clustering methods, or combined computer and human inspection method. In the binning method, we first sort the data and partition into different bins. Then each bin is smoothened either by taking bin means or by using Smith or by using bin median or by using bin boundaries. We discuss with an example how these binning methods are used. The binning can be done either by based on the equal width partitioning or by based on equal depth partitioning. In the case of equal width partitioning, we divide the range into n intervals of equal size with width W, where width is calculated here by taking the difference between the lowest value and highest value, and then by dividing with the number of attribute values, we get W. Of course, this is a very straightforward method, but the disadvantage is outliers may dominate the presentation. And also, it is very difficult to handle the skewed data in this situation. The reason is all values may belong to one bin. In that case, it is called a skewed data. Whereas, in the case of equal depth partitioning, we divide the range into n intervals, each containing approximately same number of samples. This method is very good for data scaling, and it is also useful for managing categorical attributes. Now the slide gives an example of how to do the binning methods for data smoothening. For example, if you take price values in sorted order, as shown on the slide, they are 4, 8, 9, 15, 21, 21, 24, 25, 26, 28, 29, and 34, say. In the case of equal frequency partition, which is known as equidepth partition, we divide all the data elements into three different bins of same size. First four elements are in the first bin, the next four elements are in the second bin, and the remaining elements are in third bin. Then, if I use smoothening by bin means, here the average of 4, 8, 9 and 15 are taken as the bin value for bin 1. Whereas for bin 2, all the values are replaced with the average of 21, 21, 24, 25, that is 23. Whereas bin 3, the average value is 29, so all the 4 values are replaced with 29. So this method is called smoothening by bin means. Whereas in the case of smoothening by bin boundaries, we replace each element with the closest boundary value. For example, if you take bin 1, 4 is close to 4, so 4 is replaced with 4, whereas 8 is replaced with 4 because it is close to 4 than 15. And similarly, 9 is also close to 4 than 15. That is why 9 is also replaced with 4, whereas 15 is replaced with 15 only. Similarly, for bin 2, we replace 24 with 25 because 24 is close to 25 compared to 21. Similarly, for bin 3, 28 and 29 are replaced with 26 because they are very close to 26 compared to 34. So this is called smoothening by bin boundaries. Of course, all these bin methods, smoothening methods, can be applicable not only for depth partition, but also for equi-width partitioning. Then the second kind of method for smoothening the noisy data is known as regression. In the regression, data is smoothened by fitting the data into a function. For example, if you take linear regression, it involves finding the best line to fit two attributes so that one attribute can be used to predict the other one, which is termed as linear regression. In the case of multiple linear regression, which is an extension of linear regression, this is used when more than two attributes are involved and the data are fit to a multidimensional surface. For example, the slide shows linear regression over a set of values x and y. So here the value y is equal to fx, here fx is x plus 1, is approximated by taking all the data points xi, yi. And then the data points are joined by means of a straight line approximate function. So for any given x, I can compute the approximate value for y, which is known as the linear regression. So whenever you do the regression, we should always remember that the sum of the squares of the error is kept at the minimum. Then the next method is clustering. Clustering is basically used to group all the similar elements into a group with the objective that all the elements within the cluster are highly similar, and if you take any pair of elements across the clusters, they are highly dissimilar. So by using this clustering method, you can find out even outliers very easily. For example, the figure shows three clusters. So any elements which are not belong to these clusters can be termed as outliers. We must treat data cleaning as a process, in the sense that data discrepancy detection, data migration and integration, and integration of the different processes must be done in an iterative and interactive manner. So that is why every tool must have a support to automatically detect and smoothen out the noisy data, so that we can consider the entire cleaning method as a process. So by the moment when we say the process, we must use the metadata like domain of the attributes, range of the attribute values, what is the relationship exists between the attributes, and then what is the distribution of the data. They are all important as far as the discrepancy of the detection of the data is concerned. And also sometimes we may have to check whether a field is overloaded or not. And also we must have a mechanism to check the uniqueness rule, consecutive rules, and null rules. So in fact, there are many commercial tools exist to view the data cleaning as a process. And also we must have a mechanism to transform the data from one form to another form using a migration tool. So ETL tools allow the users to specify transformations through a GUI. Of course, all the tools must work in an integration of the two iterative and interactive processes. And also all the things must be interlinked here. If I do some changes, my schema with respect to some constraints, then what is the effect of that change on the remaining data must be considered into account. That is why inferencing of the data play a key role here in data cleaning. So in a nutshell, in order to maintain the quality of the data among the sources, first of all, we should identify what type of source it is. Is it a single source or multiple source? And then what are the different problems at single source? What are the different problems at multiple source? And then how schema is defined? Is the integrity of the data is satisfied? Is the schema good? Is the uniqueness rules are satisfied, like primary key integrity and the referential integrity constraints? All these things are part of the schema level on a single source. When you take the instance, we may come across data entry errors. Sometimes you may see misspellings or redundancy or duplication, contradictory values, etc. So all these things are to be removed in order to maintain the quality of the data. The similar kind of problems may also occur in the case of multi-source problems. So when we have heterogeneous data, then if you design a data model using schema design with respect to different heterogeneous designs, then you may come across naming conflicts or structural conflicts. So we need to remove those conflicts. And similarly, at the instance level, we may have a overlapping of the data or contradictions and inconsistencies among the data may occur. Sometimes even aggregation also may be inconsistent, or timing of the data may be inconsistent. So therefore, all these problems must be resolved by considering data cleaning as a process. Then only quality of the data is good. In this lecture, we discussed why data pre-processing is needed in a data warehouse environment, what are the basic concepts that are essential to understand the data summarization issue. And finally, we concluded this lecture by highlighting different kinds of data cleaning methods. In the next lecture, we discuss further other kinds of data pre-processing methods. Thank you.